Hi, hello, good afternoon to everybody who are listening to us from Europe. Good morning if you do it from the other side of the Atlantic. We are starting the second presentation of this room, Oracle MySQL, and we will receive Gemma Rubio with us. Gemma, you can come on the stage with us, please. Gemma is a customer experience in
Defined.
Hello, Gemma, how are you? Is customer experience in Define Define. What is Define Define? Can you explain it?
With Define Define, we help customers define what is fine for them regarding communication and customer experience.
Okay. And with Gemma, we will see the paradox of human communication and the technological era can be solved. And we see if we can solve this or... or not, yes?
Yeah.
Okay. So I let you with Gemma just to remember that you can ask questions to Gemma in the Q&A. These questions, I will read this question to Gemma at the end of the presentation. And if you want to ask something and come on the stage, you can raise your hand at the end of this presentation at the same time. And we will invite you to come here on the stage with us. So just good luck, Gemma, and see you in 30, 35 minutes for the question and answer from the folks here in the Oracle room. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Philippe. Okay, hello, everyone. So yes, we are going to talk about the communications. The communication have changed a lot. If you think about the last 20, 30 years, we didn't have social media or anything, communication were completely different. And now we have to adapt and we have to communicate in a way that people can really understand each other and communicate in a way that is effective for everyone, because sometimes with the technology is a little different. But to start talking about communication, we need to understand that everything we do, we are communicating something. So it's not only when we talk and when we write a message, it's also with the clothes we wear, with the way we walk, the way we move, the way we interact. So everything we do, we are communicating something. We need to be aware of that, because even if we don't do anything, we are communicating that we are not doing anything. So we need to be aware of that, because with our communications, we create the relations. So every time we're creating relations with the way we behave. So in real life, it's easier because you have your body language, you have the tone of voice, you have everything, but it's not about you. It's about your audience. So you have to communicate in a way that your audience can see you, can understand you, and can connect with you. Because, for example, I start talking Chinese now. I'm sure most of you don't understand what I say, because it's not an easy. So I need to understand my audience. And if I know you speak English, I need to speak in English. So this is one example. But we need to use the words and everything for the audience that we have. So when we talk face-to-face, the body language help and the tone of voice. So the words are minimum. So sometimes the thing you say is not that important. If your body language, if you are happy, you are smiling, you are saying something, and the words are not that good, you can think there is a misunderstanding because you have a lot of information for outside of the words. But when we do it online, we don't have that. We only have the words. And well, we need to learn how to communicate, because if, for example, you send this message on LinkedIn to someone that you just connect and you say, hello, then it's a little weird because you don't know anything about the person. You don't know. It's like, okay, hello, but it's a little empty. So you can do that when you go to, for example, an event online and offline, and you meet a lot of people, you enter to the room and you say hello with a big smile, or you shake the hands. And then it works. But if you do it online and you just only say hello, it's a little strange. So we need to understand how to behave. Yeah, of course, we can always use the emojis. That helps. But also we need to be careful, because it depends on the situation and the person. The emoji you use, you can create confusion, because not all of us know how to read the emojis in the same way. So we need to be really aware of the way we communicate, because otherwise we cannot create relations. So we need to understand that what we communicate online is more important what we say than how we say it. It's completely different from the face-to-face, because the sentence you write everyone is going to interpret it in a way depending of the way of they are. So if I feel mad for something or I feel sick, maybe you send me a sentence and I understand something completely different than what you are meaning. If I'm happy, I will understand another thing. So we need to think a lot about the words we are using and how we are saying it in order to communicate properly. What can we do to communicate in an effective way? We need to start by managing of customer expectations. How can we manage our customer expectations? We have to do what we say we are going to do. This is the most important thing. And we have to be consistent because we need to create trust in our relation of trust. So we need to, if we say to a customer that we are going to have an appointment next week, Tuesday, we need to be there. And if we are going to deliver our work tomorrow, we have to deliver tomorrow. Something can happen. Maybe you cannot do it for any reason. You are sick or the coronavirus arrives. I don't know, anything can happen. But then you have to tell your customer. You have to tell them with enough time for them not to have a bad experience. Because if you create this bad experience, the people is not going to trust you. And if they don't trust you, they will go away. When the things go like you plan them, then you feel good. You feel rewarded. You feel happy. You're like, wow, it's great. And then you know that, okay, next week I'm going to have this, I'm going to have that, and you can organize things. You can have a good feeling for your communications. Because you need trust. If you cannot trust the other person, it's going to be really difficult to create a relationship and communicate properly. So when it's offline, it's completely different. But when it's online, the trust needs time. You cannot get trust in one person because of one message. Two, you need to have a little of communication, do things together, and then you can trust this person. You can start to create the relationship and build a good communication and understanding. The use of empathy is really important also, because you need to feel how they are, what kind of person they are, and how they will receive the information. When you have empathy, your company will have better results because then the people feel good with you and they want to be with you. I don't know if this happened to you, but for me, if I have a bad experience with a company, even if they are in the corner of my house, I don't go. I prefer to go far away or wait some time in order to have a good experience because I don't want to have a bad feeling. So for example, let's do an example of e-commerce. I order a microphone. I'm so happy because I'm going to get this microphone in 2 weeks. I'm really excited. And after 2 weeks, I receive this. And they're like, oh my goodness, this is not what I ordered. So there it can happen, two things can happen. One thing is that you call the company and you say, what I received is not what I expected. And they react fast. They send you the correct one. They pick up this and they solve in a really easy and fast way. And then it's like, okay, everyone can make a mistake. One. You cannot do this always, but if this happened once, it's okay. You can do it. And other thing can happen. You send an email. They don't send you nothing. You don't get the answer. You need to be fighting to get a call. And then you lose the trust. You cannot work with this company. So the expectations are really important. Another thing that happened, this happened to me last week. I love spicy. So I have this in my order. I order food online because of the coronavirus. I couldn't go out. And 2 hours before my order was going to be delivered, I received an email from the company. I don't going to say names. And they told me that they cannot send me jalapenos because they don't have. But they say, we are really sorry. We don't want to let you without cooking something spicy. So we are going to send you this stand and we are going to send you for free because it was our mistake. So they couldn't deliver what they tell me. But I had a good feeling because it's like, okay, they are trying to solve it. So I feel good and I continue buying from there. So if I receive the order and I don't receive my jalapenos and they don't say anything, you feel bad. Of course, this is a small detail, but this happens everywhere in life. So when you don't match the expectations, you feel really bad and you don't want to be around these kind of people. So you can trust the company, you can trust everything, but if you don't trust the people behind the way they communicate, it's going to be really bad. And we have different channels and different purposes. And the way of communicating also is completely different. We were talking about e-commerce. So you can do this kind of communication with the customers. But for example, with the email, it's completely different. In the email, you can write long things with more formal. You need to have good grammar, write in a more professional way. It can be friendly or more serious, but it's more professional. But in social media, the communication is completely different. You don't write the same kind of messages in WhatsApp that in the email. For example, in WhatsApp, to say, that's great, you can write GR8, but you will never do that in an email because it's weird. So the other way around, it happened too. Because when we talk in social media, we talk as if we are talking face-to-face. So we use it as a chat, as a friend. So I can send you a message, oh, are you going to the Open Expo? Yes, I will go today. I'll see you there. So it's more like a talk. So then the way of communicating have to be also like this. If you write too formal or in an email way in the social media, people is going to feel that it's weird. They are going to feel something strange. And for example, the period at the end of the sentences. If you send a WhatsApp and you say, for example, how are you? Good, thanks. And you put the period at the end, the people feel that like if you are mad, you are insincere, there's something is strange. Why this happened, to be honest, I have no idea. But it's because of the way we talk. It's a feeling strange. So for example, it's not the same if you made a mistake and you say to someone, I'm sorry that I feel so bad that I thought you knew it, that it won't happen again. That is like really weird. You will send that in an email, but not in WhatsApp. In WhatsApp, you can say something like, I'm so sorry, I feel so bad. I thought you knew it and it won't happen again. It's more real, more human. And you need to be a human. You need to be yourself. And we, well, for example, I write this so because I'm really enthusiastic and expressive. Other people can talk in another way, but it's the feeling. You can feel the people feel bad when you use the that. So this is a way of having misunderstandings and not communicating. Another thing that happens too often is people don't answer. And then, again, we talk like in personal life, face-to-face. So if you don't answer, people feel really bad because imagine now, for example, you are in the street and you find a person that you know and you say, hey, how are you? They say, fine, thanks. Maybe they are in a hurry, they don't stop, you don't talk too much, but you will never go without answering. So if you send someone send you a message, it's important to answer. And you don't have to be friends with everyone and talk a lot with everyone, but you need to answer. Even if you don't want to talk with this person, if you have the connection, you can always say, I don't have the time to talk now, or send me an email. You can say something to make them understand that you don't really want to have a conversation, but at least answer, because otherwise they will feel bad. And then the trust, it's difficult to happen. So when you want to have a good relation with people, you have to be yourself as you are face-to-face, as you are offline. And also it's important to use the filter, because some people feel like when you are in online, no one sees you. Well, if you are like now in video, you can see each other, you can understand the feeling of the people. But if you are in a chat, people can tell you really bad things. And they are the haters that say horrible things. And sometimes you see the people and you have met them offline. This is like, it's not the same person. Why they behave different online? So you have to put a filter and say, well, I would say the same thing to this person if we were face to face. So why are you doing it? If you have a moment, stop. And don't answer fast, because we also think that we need to answer fast. When we receive a message, we need to answer in this moment. And of course, it's important to answer as soon as you can, because everyone has the phone nearby. So if you cannot answer in this moment, sure you will see the message and you can answer. But if it's not the right moment, it's better to wait than to send something really bad, because you make people feel bad. And then to fix this and to gain trust again is going to be really difficult. So it's good to have a filter. And if you are in a bad moment, or you are mad or in a hurry because you have to go to some place, don't react. It's better to think and write in the proper way, because otherwise the people is not going to understand the message in the right way. They are going to feel bad. And you need to understand that maybe the other person is feeling bad or stressed. So it's important to have this kind of filter to connect and to have the most respectful connection. If you say something wrong and you say something that you wouldn't say, that's it, the people is going to go away. So I always use a sentence that someone told me, that if you are going to send a message in social media or even a photo before sending it, think about how will you feel if that person put it in the newspapers, in the front page. Will you feel good? Will you feel proud about what you say? If it's a no, if you will feel ashamed and you will have problems, then don't do it, because it's not going to bring you anything good. So it's important to know your target, to know to who you are talking, who they are, how they feel, to know their concerns, their needs, because once you know that, you can communicate in a way that they will feel good. And it's important to make people feel good because we want also to feel good. And we want to work with people and have a good experience, good feeling. We don't want to finish a conversation and feel bad. So it's really important to know your target, to know who they are, what they want, and what they need. It's not only to create a buyer persona for the person that you want to buy your product. It's also to find who is really buying your product. Because one thing is what you want, and another thing is who is there, who is buying your product. It's really important to know the data and talk to them and talk the way they need it. And also, if you use platform, use the platform where they are. And when you communicate inside your product, you have an app or an online platform or everything, it's important to put yourself in your customer suit, because a lot of people is not used to work with technology. But from my experience, people don't tell you, I don't know how it works, or it's too difficult for me. What usually they say is, no, this is not for me. I don't like it. It's not for me. I prefer face-to-face, because it's a little difficult when everyone is with the phone and connected to say, no, it's difficult. I don't understand. So the people, they won't tell you. You need to read a little your customers and the people that you are going to talk to, and go to their level of knowledge and communicate in a way that is easy for them. So when they understand, they will start interacting with you and they will feel more comfortable and they will trust you more, because communication is about trust. And the experience that you offer with your brand is what matters the most. So if the people feel good around you, they feel proud about what you are doing, how you are communicating, how you are interacting, they want to be part of it. But if they feel that you treat them bad, because you can have the best company, a really huge company with a product that works really good, but if the service, when you call, they don't answer the phone, or they send a message, an email, and they don't send you an email back, you don't know what to expect from this company. At the end, you go to another brand, because there are many brands that have a really good product. So they are not going to be with you if their communication is not good. So it's important also to use the feedback that your customers give you, because it's the really good information. Then the customers that give you feedback is a really small percentage. I think it's 1 or 2%, but you can use this information. If you use this percentage, they tell you what they don't understand. They tell you what is difficult, what is not working, and then you can fix it. So this is really good, and you can create even material to help them understand. You can create more videos if they like videos, or you can create even gifts to make them communicate. So you need to understand what will be easier for them to understand. It's the same as a communication for one-to-one on LinkedIn, for example. If you are talking with a student, you don't talk the same way and using the same words that if you talk a an expert that is working 40 years in the same concept that you. So you need to adapt to the people that is receiving your communications. And important, really important, is to understand also that the bad service is the worst. And you have a bad service, you will lose the customers. So you need to think in all the interaction that you have, all the emails, all the one-to-one messages, the times you send the messages, how you organize the communications in the company, what you give them, what they expect from you, because this is really, really important. Otherwise, yeah, you see 68% people leave the company because the service is really bad. And no one wants to have this experience. The people want to feel happy and good. Their life is so difficult sometimes that you don't want to surround yourself with people that make you feel bad. So that's the way to improve the digital communications. And this is all right now. I don't know if you are there, Philippe.
No way. I was trying to do multitasks. This is very, very difficult for me. I have a video for you, just a second. It was on, I share with obviously everyone.
Okay, I just put.
I feel good. I knew that I would not.
It's just to answer on your presentation. So I was aware on your presentation. So thank you very much for the presentation. If someone has a question, he can do it through the Q&A on the right part of the screen, or he or she can raise the hand directly, and we will invite him or her to come here on the stage. So if someone wants to come on the stage, just raise your hand and I will invite you to come here. So I have a question here.
Okay.
Do you think that automated bot communication should look like a real people communication? What people feeling in case of they talk to a bot but do not know about this? Two questions in one.
Yeah, it depends the kind of bot, how they interact, because sometimes it's too mechanic that you read. And if you don't know, because there is a lot of people that they don't know anything about bots. So it's like, this person is, what is talking to me? It's not related. Sometimes they don't answer exactly what you are asking, because not all the people create the questions in the right way for the bot. So it's a little tricky. It depends. I think it depends how you use it and to which target you use it.
Okay. And how can you ask something to a bot? Sometimes I feel like I'm talking to a chatbot or whatever, and I'm trying to know how a bot is working, to know how to make the question to make him or it answer me in a good way. But it should be the other part. A chatbot, you have to adapt yourself to a chatbot. It's not a good chatbot. No,
it's not good. That's why I say that if you are used to have bots, you can understand that it's a bot, and then you don't feel bad. You know there is a standard answers, but sometimes you ask something and you feel bad. So I think if your target is, for example, old people that they are not that used to technology, they will feel bad with the
okay, yeah.
So if you really know there is a bot, then it's okay, because you know it's not a person. But if you try to make it too human and then their answer is not human, you will feel confused. You will feel bad because it's like, what is this person telling me?
Yeah, I think this will improve in the next few years with AI, and this will get better and better each time, and we will have great chatbot working on Helps to Help. Next question: what do you think about video conference exhaustion? During this COVID period, people has complained that even video conferences are not a replacement for face-to-face.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's not a replacement, but it's the most similar we have in this situation. And it is true that now it's too much. Everyone is doing things online, and at the end it's like, okay, I'm all day, 24 hours, looking to a screen. But it helps a lot. Because, for example, I live in the Netherlands, but I do business in Spain, and I do business in England. Now I'm doing a project also in Russia. So it helps a lot, because you cannot be traveling to four countries at the same time. So I think it's a good thing. It's the closest to have a human relation, because now, for example, if I say a sentence that you cannot understand properly, if I'm laughing, you know it's something good. At least you can have an idea. But if you send a message and it's another country with a different culture, you need to be more careful about what you say and how you say it. Because even in some countries that we speak Spanish, I have a lot of relation with Cubans. The same sentence can be positive in Spain and negative in Cuba. Exactly the same sentence. So if you do it live, you can see the people, you can see it's good what you are saying. But if they write it to you, you're like, why they are saying this to me? I know it because I know a lot of people there. But if you don't know it, it can be a problem.
Okay, next question, just to remember, record people, you can ask question if you want. You can raise the hand and you will come on the stage to ask the question directly with your camera and your microphone. And next question, I see on this question, maybe I can improve myself with my background, maybe. it's what I've got. Maybe I should have used a blur application or something to avoid all of this. And so the question, it's not a question, it's any suggestion for a good video conference, background, camera, etc.
Well, I use one that is for Mac, and it's called Ecamm with two M's. And it's really good because it's really easy. You don't need to know much about setting it up. You just enter and it works. So it's really easy. And now I'm trying to use another one that is called OBS. That this is really good for the background, and it's free. It's a free one. But I still need to learn how it works.
And recommendation about the camera, maybe the quality, the light, the quality of the microphone, the noise behind you. Because, for example, I just saw that few days ago, Google said that there had artificial intelligence to avoid all the kids' noise, the doors, and whatever. Maybe there are some suggestions on this part too, because right now it's not solved, this noise from the outside. So what could be the advices on this part?
Well, the one that I always use, that tool Meet, the Google Meet for meetings, because actually it's not working yet, but it's better. I don't use Zoom. I don't like it. Sorry. But I like Google Meet, and it's really good for conferencing. Now you can have until September, because of the coronavirus, also you can have, I think it's until 100,000 people. So you can make a really huge event there. You can record it. And it was really good. It's really easy to use.
So I think there is no more question. I don't know if you want to add something before finishing this conference right now.
Well, I would like to add that try to be yourself when you're communicating, to be honest. And also one thing that I forgot to say, if you do something bad, you can always say sorry, because we are learning how to communicate in digital, all of us, so we can make misunderstandings or confusion. It's always good to say sorry. I did it wrong. It's not a problem.
Okay, thank you very much. See you later in the next session as a presenter. I'm just here for a while, so if you want, you can close the camera and microphone. And just say people that they can they will have another conference in 30 minutes with Esther Amor from IBM. And it's open source and big data far beyond Hadoop. And meanwhile, you can use the rooms, the tables. You are here seated with other people, or you can move from one table to another to network with people with your camera, your microphone. You can communicate, and you can take the advantage of the advices from Gemma. So let's see you in half an hour, and enjoy the experience, and do a great networking in this time. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.